you would, take your red hymn books with me this morning and turn over to hymn number 164. 164. Over the offering this morning.
Holy Heavenly Father, we do come before your presence, praise and honor and worship you this morning. We thank you for that privilege. Lord, we thank you for the salvation that you provided through the Lord Jesus Christ, that, Lord, we can have that forgiveness of sin. And Lord, we ask you to bless this offering now, use it for your honor and glory. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. May be seated.
Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, light.
with hymn number 240. 240, and after the first verse, the choir will come down and we'll go around and greet each other, welcome each other to the house of the Lord this morning.
All I
number 240, that last verse. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith to do his blessed will. Oh, all afar about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face. Rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Turn over one more this morning to hymn number 372. 372.
Ms. Linda has a special for us this morning. Ms. Linda, you come.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the street. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors, in the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth has been suspended as the king comes through the gate. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed. Broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children and the aged, hand in hand, stand all ago, who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. The King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now is His face I see. The King is coming. The King is coming. Praise God, He's coming for me. I can hear the chariots rumble. I can see the marching throng and the flurry of God's trumpets spell the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolding. Heaven's grandstand's all in place. Heaven's choir is now assembled. Start to sing Amazing Grace. The King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now His face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, He's coming. Sounding, and now His face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, He's coming for me.
Oh, it's great to know He's coming. Amen. Even better to know that you're ready to meet Him whenever He comes. Amen. If you would, let's take your Bibles this morning and go to the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 14. The Gospel of Luke, chapter number 14. And whenever you find your place, I'll invite you to stand with me this morning as we honor the reading of God's Word. Luke chapter number 14, and we're going to go down to verse number 25. Amen. Luke chapter 14, verse number 25 says, "And there went great multitudes with Him, and He turned and said unto them, If any man come to Me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be My disciple. Whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after Me cannot be My disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he have sufficient to finish it? Lest haply, after he hath laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going to make war against another king, sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet him that cometh against him with 20,000. Or else, while the other is yet a great way off, he sendeth an ambassage and desireth conditions of peace. So likewise, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be My disciple." I want to bring our message this morning of, is it worth it? Is it worth it? Let's pray. Lord, we want to thank You once again for allowing us this great privilege of being in Your house. Thank You, Lord, for the wonderful hymns that we've been able to sing today and for the special music, Lord. How much it tenders our heart to turn our eyes to heaven, Lord, to recognize that You are coming again. So, Lord, I pray, Father, that we would examine ourselves and see what it is that You're going to find when You come. Help us, Lord, to be a disciple that's faithful and true in all that You lay before us. We just want to thank You for it and praise You in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please do be seated. Yeah, I got to thinking throughout this week, we've only got about a third of this year that's actually remaining. Amen?
just to let you know, even though it's 110, Christmas is right around the corner. Amen. It's just going to happen real quick. Amazingly, that last portion of the year, it goes by so very fast. There's Thanksgiving and Christmas, and there's all these events and travel and family and all these things. And before you know it, it's just going to be over. I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, I know we're in August, but we are looking at the end right about here. And I was reading through this passage in verse 28 and 29 and verse number 30. He brings up this topic of finishing, about finishing. And it just made me want to question, how do you plan to finish this year? How do you plan to finish? Now's the time, amen? Now's the time we need to look at it, not on December 20th and say, well, I better do something for the Lord right quick because we're coming up to a new year. How are you going to finish the year? Three times in this passage, there's that thought of finishing what it is that has been started. And it's used in context with discipleship. Jesus said there's some things that will often get in the way of a steady walk with the Lord. He talks about that, even good things, whenever he says in verse number 26, often misrepresented, it says, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And say, man, you know, that seems like a lot of animosity that you got to have to be a disciple of the Lord. You got to hate your mama, hate your daddy. You know, that's not what he's talking about. Whenever you look at hate, it's talking about it something that is in opposition to love. And whenever there's something that you love more than the Lord, you're not going to fulfill what it is that he has laid before you. As a disciple, he is supposed to have the preeminent place in our life. He is supposed to be first. That's been the theme of this year that we've established here, was Jesus first throughout this year. And certainly that's true in this matter of discipleship. But some things are good, but they can get in the way. Sometimes good things can become a burden in our life. Sometimes we have such a desire to avoid such of any kind of a hardship that we put off the Lord. So I started looking at that word finish and how much Jesus keeps saying. He says, how are you going to finish? What are they going to say whenever you're, whether you do finish or whether you don't finish? And I was looking at it, and I started kind of studying out those words a bit. And in verse number 28, it's interesting. It means to bring to completion. Whenever you see that finish, obviously so, to bring to completion. But then I started looking, and it comes from a couple of root words, and I started looking at these root words, and it's pretty interesting that that word finish that he uses right there, it means to bring to completion from this point that you're at, bringing to completion. Jesus was bringing instruction that whenever you are planning to start, you need to plan to finish. Amen. If you're laying out the plans, you need to be looking at finishing just like you look at starting. But along the way, there needs to be some checkpoints in our life as well. There need to be some times that we look at and say, from this point on, how am I going to finish? How do we finish from where we're at right now? But before we'll ever get to that question of how we're going to finish, the first question that we have to face is, will we? Amen. Will we finish? The disciples had to come to that determination many times. It's interesting when I love looking at the lives of the disciples. I like looking at the lives of all the characters in Scripture. It's just so it's so great to be able to pick one apart and then just go all the way through and follow that believer's life all the way through, and Old Testament, New Testament, whatever, and just to be able to see all the hardships and difficulties and the decisions that are laid before them. But the disciples had to make that determination many times. Whenever Jesus came walking by the seashore, and James and John were out there casting a net, and Peter and Andrew the same, and he said, follow me and I'll make you to become fishers of men. They had a decision to make of whether or not they were going to follow him. Whenever he came walking up to Matthew's table where he was exchanging the customs there and taking in the tax money, hated by everybody, and he said, follow me, Matthew had to determine whether or not he was going to follow him or not. Whenever Jesus spoke to the multitudes and he told them if they were going to be saved, it was going to have to be because they had to be in Christ. And he explained it in very graphic terms there. And they looked and they said, I don't know about all that. And they turned around and began to leave. And he looked over to the disciples. He said, will you leave also? Remember, it was Peter. And he spoke up. He said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. But you know, they had to come to that decision of what they were going to do. Jesus said to his disciples, he said, whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with them twain. They had to think about that. Amen. What did that mean? That means you got a soldier that's coming by. They had the right to be able to recruit you and say, I need you to carry my pack for 1 mile. And that was the obligation. Didn't matter if they were going the opposite direction of where you were going. You had to take the pack and you had to carry that 40-pound pack of theirs, and you had to go that 1 mile. Jesus said, don't stop there. Go an extra mile. They had to make the determination whether they were going to do that or not. Whenever Jesus was crucified on the cross for the sins of man, the disciples They saw those things, and they had to determine if they're going to be willing to see their walk with Jesus all the way to the end. Ultimately, each time, they would have to ask themselves this question, is it worth it? Is it worth it to follow God? If it was not, then there's no reason for them to finish. Amen. They'd just go back to what they knew. If it wasn't worth it, then there was too much that they were going to have to put aside of themselves, of their own life, for Jesus to be able to take the first place. But if the Savior's sacrifice was important to them, and if His unending love meant something to them, if they appreciated the constant provision that He had provided for them, if they were thankful for the fact that they didn't have to go to hell whenever they died, if they recognized that their testimony for the Lord Jesus Christ could cause another soul to be saved and forever know an eternity in heaven instead of hell, if they could reason those things out, they would see that understanding that they needed to finish. Amen. They needed to routinely say, from this point on, I'm going to finish. You know, they were people just like us. Amen. We all have our ups and downs. We have our struggles. We have some times where we're like, boy, I blew it. And then that's good. Lord, I don't know if y'all have ever made this. Lord, that's the last time I'm going to blow it. Yeah. That's probably what the Lord says too. No. He knows us. Amen. He understands the fault, but there's going to be routine things in our life where you look and you're like, man, I just got off track, but the finish line's coming. Man, I'm thankful for the end of the year. So sometimes it helps us to be able to look and say, hey, this thing has come to a finality. You don't have much of 2023 left. Man, Jesus is coming soon. The King is coming. How are we going to be found for it? Is He worth it to you? That's the question that we face. Is it worth it for us to finish with Christ? Is Jesus worth you giving your all for Him through the end of the year? I want you to turn back with me real quick to Mark chapter number 10. Mark chapter number 10, just thinking of somebody who recognized just how worth it was whenever he recognized what Jesus did for him. Mark chapter number 10, and we're going to look at the account real quick of blind Bartimaeus. He was a beggar by the roadside there. And at the end of Mark chapter number 10, beginning in verse number 46, it says, and they came to Jericho, and he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people. A blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace, but he cried out the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still, and he commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he, casting away his garment, rose, and he came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said to him, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight. And watch this, he followed Jesus in the way. Blind Bartimaeus received this gift of his sight. He didn't have to pay for it. Jesus received no compensation for this great miracle in Bartimaeus' life and the restoration of his sight, the most valuable thing that he had. But once he received that sight, he didn't keep going back and sitting by the highway anymore begging. His life had completely changed. He decided he was going to follow Jesus in the way, is what it says in verse number 52. It was the full response related to what Jesus was worth to him. He had the greatest value given to him. He says, how could I ever go my own way? How could I even go back to what I was before? He says, I just want to follow Jesus. You know, the Lord has such a desire for us to be able to follow Him. I think if we could just look and say, you know, I wish I could see what it is that Jesus is going to do through us, how God is going to work through us through the remainder of our life. Wouldn't that be fun? You're like, no. Wouldn't be. It wouldn't be for me, amen? I'd like to be able to see that, but he doesn't necessarily show it to us, but we do understand something about the potential and the desire of God. Yeah. And whenever we do that, then it starts to just kind of put a floodlight on all of our lives. That's right. I was talking with Pastor Garber this week, and he's the preacher that's going to be at the Godly Heritage Family Conference, September the 21st through the, everybody say 24th. 21st through the 24th. And we were talking about all the details and different ideas. And we were just talking about different things and different ways that this would work and that would work. And we're putting all these things together. And it was just, let's just pray about it a little bit. Let's pray some and see. And I just want to tell you, there's a lot that's going into this. The purpose is not to be able to say, you need a meeting. Hey, come on up. We'll do this preaching thing for a little while. We'll hang out. Our families will go out and eat. That's not what it's about. Amen. Listen, the prayer is already being invested. The desire of God is already being sought. Why? Because there's an interest that God has in every family of this church. Amen. You can't even look. And throughout this, you're like, well, you know, I don't really have a family anymore. It doesn't matter. You are the family. Amen. God has something for you. God is going to equip you during this week. And we look at it like, man, God has such a great interest that he is going to accomplish so much. You know, our kids need to understand something about the glory of God in a person's life. Yeah. A husband and a wife need to know how it is that they can love one another and enjoy their time together and have a common goal. Amen. And we look at it and you say, well, it's a conference. Listen, it is a Thursday through a Sunday. It's not, you know, nobody's asking for 6 months of your life. Yeah. Just saying a Thursday through Sunday that will completely change your home. Yeah. Let God just have his perfect will and way. And it pains me that there's going to be some that'll say, it just isn't worth it to me. It's kind of late. It might be dark. Might be. Yeah. Could be. Ask somebody for a ride. Amen. Listen, if we understand that God, the Almighty God, has something important for us, what is it that's going to stand in the way?
Nothing. That's right.
Amen. That's what it should be. It should be, I don't want anything to take me off course. I want to finish my course with joy and power in God. Jesus asked, am I worth it to you? And if so, will you plan to finish? Will you make it your plan? If you're going to plan to finish, I'll give you just a couple of things. First off, it's going to begin with some earnest intentions. Some earnest intentions. Back over in our text in verse number 28, he says, for which of you intending to build a tower? There's an intention there. Sometimes intentions get confused with ambitions. They're not the same thing. Ambitions are fueled by thoughts of our personal success. If there's a cause that seems to be a lost cause and it seems to be unprofitable, you are not going to have much ambition to sink your time and your money, your resources, yourself into that. But whenever Jesus called his disciples to follow him, their attentions were turned. It wasn't just a matter of an affection. Their affections were turned to his kingdom, to his work, to his life that possessed them. It became their intention to follow him. This was not just an earthly ambition. This was the cause of Christ. And there was no greater pursuit. Remember whenever God called Abraham to leave his kindred and to leave his country to go to a place that he'll tell you of later. Man, you think about this. The rest of the world would look at Abraham and he said, where are you going, Abraham? Don't know. Well, are you just leaving? You coming back? Nope. Why are you doing that? I mean, have you got a big business venture? You got something that you're going to plan? New company you're going to start? Nope. Or how are you going to make a living? Don't know. The rest of the world would look at that and they're like, this man's insane. He is absolutely crazy. The rest of the world would think that was a foolish errand. But if Abraham was driven by an ambition for earthly gain, then his direction wouldn't make any sense. Wouldn't make any sense. But if his intention was to honor God, then he's going to start walking. Amen. Amen. That's the life of the disciple. Now notice what led to this thought. Back up to verse number 27. Verse 27, Jesus says, and whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. That's a phrase that often is misunderstood. So whosoever doth not bear his cross. A lot of times people talk about that. They'll have some kind of a hardship in life. They'll have some kind of hardship in life and they'll say, well, that must be my cross to bear. That's not what the phrase means. That's not at all what it is that he is speaking of in that manner. A lot of times, you know, we'll have some sin or something, that one of those easily besetting sins the psalmist talks about. And we're like, well, it's just my cross to bear. Nope. No. If you follow the Lord, he says, you know, we're supposed to take those things and cast them at the feet of Jesus. Amen. So why are we taking a an event or a problem and saying that it's our cross to bear. Well, we got to look and say, what exactly was the cross? And how is it that we bear that cross? What does it actually mean to us? The cross was the place where Jesus suffered for others. That's what it is that took place on the cross. Turn over with me real quick to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Keep your Bibles handy. Amen. Amen, preacher. That's why we came. We want to hold up the Bible. Amen. Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. But he made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And watch this, being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That's the cross. Whoa, where was the cross? What is the cross? It's the place where Jesus emptied himself for you and me. It's the place where he emptied himself of you for you and me. Jesus said in Luke chapter 9 and verse number 23, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Now, if I'm going to follow Jesus, you know what he says? You're going to have to bear your cross. What does that mean? It means I'm going to have to empty myself of all the vain ambitions and with an honest intention set out to finish what it was that was started whenever Jesus Christ made me into a new creature. Amen. That's what we're supposed to do. That's what it means to bear your cross. It means empty yourself of self and walk for the Lord. He goes on to say back in our text in verse number 33, he says, so likewise, in that same manner, whosoever he be of you that forsaketh not all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. Now, this is where, again, people get confused. They get confused and they say, well, you know, apparently I got to hate mom and daddy to follow Jesus. And then apparently I got to give up everything that I've ever known of any kind of a physical thing that I've ever given. We got to, you know, shave our head and be monks in Tibet and then we'll be able to follow Jesus. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, empty yourself of you. Get over self. Get away from the vanity of the flesh and all the affections that take you away from the most important thing in your life, which is the Lord Jesus Christ himself, and follow him. Yeah. As a disciple, you're trading what you already have for what it is that you have promised to become. Yeah. It's God's word. You know, that's in direct contrast than what the world has to think. Amen. I mean, the worldly method is, you know, that bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. It's all a matter of what can you grab? Yeah. Amen. Grab another one if you can, but right now, what are you holding on to? You know, God says, turn loose of everything. Yeah. Turn loose of the stuff and you just follow me and you'll see what it is that God intends to do. That should be our intention in life. Nobody stumbles into being a disciple. You don't just accidentally wake up and say, man, I don't know what happened. I tripped and, you know, here I am. I've just been walking all this. You make a conscious effort. You start walking with Christ because you understand the value of his name. That's what it is. If you plan to finish, secondly, there has to be some accurate accounting. There has to be some accurate accounting. Now look what he says here in verse number 28. He says, for which of you, intending to build a tower, sitteth not down first and counteth the cost, whether he hath sufficient to finish it? We need to have that right understanding of what that means as well. What does it mean to count the cost? He's not saying, well, if you think about coming with me, you better get ready to count everything as loss because you're going to lose it all. That's not what it is that he's saying. Some people think that today. That's not what it means. They believe that whenever you follow Jesus, well, you're going to have to kiss your comfort goodbye. No, that's, you know, put on your sackcloth and ashes, cut the air conditioner off. That's what it means to follow Jesus. Jesus said he had nowhere to lay his head. Now, he's saying to be a disciple takes an accurate account of what it's going to take to finish that walk that you're on. That's what the accounting is. It's measuring up and saying, what is it that you have and what is it that's going to be provided? Now, whenever you take an accurate account, you know what you find out? You find out that what he just said, he says, I'm supposed to empty myself of me. So what do I have to contribute to the plan here? Nothing. Amen. So what is it that's going to accomplish the will of God? It must be the power of God and the Spirit of God that's working within me. Amen. Amen. He's the one that does the work. He's the one that gets the glory. I'm simply a vessel for him to use. Yeah. It takes the emphasis off of me. It ain't nothing about me. Amen. But whenever you can wake up and say, God, I don't have anything, but you are everything. And God, I'll just be a vessel for you to use if you'll just use me. Man, start looking. Amen. Because God is going to be able to use somebody that is surrendered to Him. When Jesus says that they're to count the cost, He says, make sure that you are prepared to look at this walk all the way to completion. Because if you're looking at your own strength and your own power to be able to get you from point A all the way to your ending point, you will never make it. Your flesh will fail. Your strength is going to fail. Your ability is going to fail. Your interest is going to fail. He says, it's not about you. It's about the grace of God that is sufficient to meet your every need to carry you right where it is He wants you to go. You can be sure there's going to be other things that are going to try to get your attention off of Christ. Why is that? Why would Satan work through so many different areas, even good things, to be able to get your eyes off Christ? Because that's the only power you've got. That's the strength that you have. And if you can start following after something else outside of Jesus, then Satan says, I got a victory there, because there's nothing going to be accomplished by his own flesh, not for the glory of God. Jesus says, as a disciple, he says, sit down at the very beginning and count the cost. Recognize what it is that's going on. Recognize that you've got to be empty of self and pour all that out and trust in God himself. Jesus gives two illustrations that remind us of that need that we have for accounting. We have to account for the building and the battling. The building and the battling. Those are the two illustrations that he gives if you're going to finish. First of all, he talks about that building of the tower. Look at it in verse number 28. He says, for which of you, intending to build a tower, he says, that's your intent, you're going to build a tower, sitteth not down first, counteth the cost, whether he hath sufficient to finish it. So he says, there's the building. And then he goes down to verse number 31, and he begins to speak of a king and battling in war. In verse number 31, he says, or what king going to make war against another king sitteth not down first and consulteth whether he be able with 10,000 to meet the needs, or to meet him rather, that cometh against him with 20,000. He says, there's building and there's battling. You know, it's pretty interesting because that is a consistent theme throughout Scripture. There's this matter all through Scripture. He's telling us, he says, there's building and there's battling. There's building and there's battling. Just a little bit prior to this, Jesus was speaking to his disciples. Turn over to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16. He said, I know where this one is. Amen. Matthew chapter number 16. Now notice what he's doing here. He's giving that same pattern. He's talking to the disciples. This is about 6 months before he's talking to them right here. And he says, 6 months before, he says, let me just go ahead and tell you. He said, there's some building going on and there's some battling that's going on. So Matthew chapter number 16, and we'll start up in verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremiah, one of the prophets. He saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? Now watch this, verse 16. And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Now watch this, verse 18. He says, and I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, talking about that statement he just made in verse number 16, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He says, upon this rock I will build my church, now watch this, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. What's he doing? Building and battling. He says, I'm building the church. He says, hell doesn't appreciate that at all. Hell will certainly try to battle against it, not to prevail, amen, but there is a battle that's going on. Jesus came to this earth to build, and in the process, there's a battle that's going on. It was like Nehemiah. We talked about Nehemiah just the other day. I don't remember when, Sunday, Wednesday, sometime. Had to be. Amen. So, but it was one of those. And Nehemiah, he's in the process of building the wall. And Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 17 and 18, you don't have to turn there, but it says, they which build it on the wall, and they that bear burdens with those that laid it, every one with one of his hands wrought in the work, and the other hand held a weapon. He says, remember, what's the guy's name? Charles Spurgeon. Charles Spurgeon had that newspaper, The Sword and the Trowel. Amen? That's where it was coming from. He goes on, he says, verse number 18, he says, for the builders, everyone had his sword girded by his side, and so builded. And he sounded the trumpet. He that sounded the trumpet was by me. He says, one hand, he's got his trowel working, he's building. On the other hand, he's got his sword. Amen? Why is that? Because there was building, but there was battling as well. And now Jesus tells his disciples, whenever he's talking about discipleship, and he's telling me, he says, hey, you're going to have to finish what you start. You know what he's telling them? He says, there's going to be some building, but there's going to be some battling as well. And he says, if you're going to do that, you're going to have to count the cost. He says, at the beginning, whenever you sit down, count the cost so that you'll be able to see this work all the way through to completion. The structure is beyond your own ability. The battle is stronger than what it is that you can fight in your flesh. He said, make sure that you don't overcount the power of your own ability. Through Christ, the will of God is going to be accomplished. So what's God building? Through discipleship. Think about this. He's talking to them. That's the context of it all, amen. He's talking to them about what it means to be a disciple, a follower of Christ. And he says, all right, what is it exactly that is going to be built in you? You know who he's building in each of your lives? He's building godliness in his disciples. And can I tell you, that'll take a lifetime of faith. You'll never get to the point where you're like, I'm the epitome. You will be gone. That's when it happens. 2 Peter 1, verses 5 through 8 says, beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, the virtue knowledge, and knowledge temperance, temperance patience, patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, you know what I'm doing? He says, I'm building godliness in you. And you know what happens whenever that godliness begins to prevail in your life? It begins to extend to others, and there's going to be a fruit that remains. To finish, there's earnest intentions. There's accurate accounting. And lastly, there's an undaunted dependence. Undaunted dependence. Look at what he says in verse number 29. He says, lest haply, after he hath laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. He says, you're going to have to do the accounting. Recognize that in your own strength, you cannot accomplish it. He said, you might get a foundation started, but he said, it'll be a testimony to everybody of the failure that happened whenever you try to depend upon your own strength. We are continually dependent upon the Lord. He says, there's going to be people that begin to mock you. What is the reason for mocking? You ever think about that? I mean, what's really the purpose of a mocker? Some people you just look at and they like to mock everything. They scoff at everything that they can. And you look at it and you're like, is there any benefit? I mean, do they get any joy out of that? I don't think so. They'd probably stop. There's two big results of mocking. There's discouragement and there's division. There's discouragement and division. There are always those that desire to see a Christian fail. Jesus said in Matthew 5:11, he says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Jesus said, you need to figure out what you're going to do and do it now. At this point, you need to determine if you're going to finish. Because whenever you don't and people begin to mock, he said, it's going to be a bad testimony on you. It's going to be a bad testimony on me because they're looking at your strength instead of mine. Oftentimes in life, we have this tendency to magnify problems. It's what we do. It doesn't matter. You can have 99 wonderful days. That one bad day, that's what it is that gets magnified. But Jesus came as the answer to life problems. Anytime there's a problem, you know what happens? There is a potential for division to be caused among God's people. The disciples, they would deal with that very early on. In the book of Acts, there was murmuring against them because there was the thought that the widows had been neglected. They were going through this matter. It was honestly a temptation. They were being tempted to leave that most important work of which they were called to do. Now, you look at that, and obviously nobody wants the widows to be neglected. The widows would have been greatly excited for them to be able to stop what they're doing and just tend to all their needs. They would have been great. They would have been happy for a time. But if they would have stopped doing what it was that they were called to actually do, what the job that God gave them to do, then the church would not be healthy. Right. Now, they had an answer for it. That's where the deacons came from. Amen. That's what he said. It's like, hey, we're gonna make those needs. We realize it's a legitimate concern. We need to be able to do those things. But the temptation is to be able to take them away from what it is that God called them to do, of the study of the Word of God and proclaiming the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. God's people often are tempted, even with the matter of good, godly service. And we have to be able to look and say, wait a minute, Christ has to be first. His direction, it has to be first. God has an answer for whatever problems that you have in life, but he has to be first. Martha dealt with that same matter as well, that thought of division and strife and things. When remember, it was Martha and Mary, and it said that Martha was cumbered about with much service. Man, all of a sudden, remember we saw it not too awful long ago, but whenever Martha was cumbered about by service, then she started getting all bitter about it, amen? Man, she was upset about it all. She was bitter against her sister. She said, Mary, good for nothing, just sitting around, not doing anything. Then she started getting bitter toward her service. What it was that she was supposed to be doing, she didn't even want to serve anymore. She didn't so much to say it, but she was complaining about it. And then, before long, she was bitter against her Savior. Remember what she said? Lord, carest thou not? Lord, don't you care what I'm going through here? I'm trying to serve and nobody's helping me. There's that bitterness. The more that we exalt ourselves, the more those magnified problems get the best of us. Many believers get bitter toward the things of God because they try to serve in the power of their own flesh and the power of God instead of the power of God. Anytime you try to serve in your own flesh instead of the power of God, it's going to become a huge burden to you. It's going to be so difficult. And you just can't understand why it is there. Man, there's going to be stone casting. No sorry Christians. Nobody's helping me. And I don't like me. And I don't like anything. And I don't like that church. And it comes down to saying, and by the way, the Lord's not helping me either. All because we trust in the power of the flesh rather than the power of God. God gives us some troubles in life. He allows some troubles in life. Why is that? So we, like Mary, remember what Jesus said whenever Martha said, Lord, carest thou not? Nobody's here helping me. Lord, don't you care? Don't you see? And remember what Jesus said? He said, Mary hath chosen that good part. He said, Mary was sitting at my feet being taught. He said, that is the good part. And a lot of times the Lord will allow some troubles in our life so that he'll give us the opportunity to choose the good part. That's what this opposition was picking apart of a disciple. Let's say in verse number 30, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. Probably true. The work of man will fail. It will fail. The work of God will not. We have to be involved in the work of God. If the disciples are going to finish what it is that God started in them, it's not just by their perseverance, it's not by their personal strength, but it's by the dependence on the Lord who cannot fail. The grace of God is sufficient to see you through. You know, as we're facing this final third of the year, right here, down, we are at the home stretch. I hope that you're determined to choose the good part. The Lord is worth it all. He is the risen Savior, amen? He gave his very life for the payment of your sins. You know, without Jesus, you would be going to a devil's hell. That's right. The greatest of this day would seem like a drop in the bucket. It wouldn't even measure up because at the end of it all, there would be eternal torment and suffering. But Jesus. Oh, I love it when Jesus butts in. Amen? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. He accomplished what we could never accomplish on our own. He is the risen Savior. He gives you the opportunity to receive his gift of salvation. The righteousness of his name gets applied to your account. You get eternity with him. He's worth it all. He's done it all. If you're saved, I pray that from this point you make that determination to finish what he started in you. If you're not saved, today's your day of salvation. What a great opportunity to receive Christ. Have the earnest intentions, some accurate accounting. Keep the undaunted dependence upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's all stand together. We'll have a hymn of invitation. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your love and grace and the many blessings that you extend. We thank you, Lord, that you care so very much for us. We thank you, God, for your presence in this place and all that you do to be able to meet needs. And Lord, I pray, Father, that as we all come, we've got different burdens of our heart, different things that maybe have been tempted to take us away from the good thing today that you have for us. Lord, I pray, Father, that we would be settled on setting our life in accordance with the cause of Christ. Help us, Lord, to be able to honor you in every decision. Lord, if there's one here that doesn't know Christ as Savior, I do pray that today would be the day of salvation. And Lord, for each of us, I pray, Lord, that we could humbly submit to you, yield to you, Lord, looking toward this ending and asking for your help to finish what was started. We want to thank you and praise you for every decision. In Jesus' name we do pray.
Amen.
Hymn number 270.
270. If you need to come and pray, I want you to.